From the library of the New York Stock Exchange at the corner of Wall and Broad Streets in New York City, you're inside the Ice House. Our podcast from Intercontinental Exchange on markets, leadership, and vision in global business. The dream drivers that have made the NYSE an indispensable institution of global growth for over 225 years. Each week, we feature stories of those who hatch plans, create jobs, and harness the engine of capitalism. Right here, right now at the NYSE and at ICE's exchanges and clearinghouses around the world. And now welcome Inside the ICE House. Here's your host, Josh King of Intercontinental Exchange.
In February 1784, a young nation, the United States of America, embarked on a historic venture, dispatching a trading vessel to one of the world's most ancient and storied civilizations. Major Samuel Shaw and John Green, overseeing a load of 30 tons of ginseng, $18,000 in silver coin, and a copy of the Declaration of Independence, embarked on the ship Empress of China. Their voyage concluded 7 months later in August, anchoring in Guangzhou, southern China, marking the formal commencement of diplomatic and trade relations between the two nations. The bilateral relationship between the U.S. and China remains one of the most significant and intricate in the world. Since the founding of the PRC under Mao Zedong in 1949, the two powers have navigated periods of both tension and cooperation, addressing a spectrum of critical issues including trade, climate change, and now the emerging domain of artificial intelligence. To give a glimpse of the modern stakes, here's a clip from my recent Inside the Ice House conversation with Tom Siebel, founder, chair, and CEO of C3 AI.
We are at war in the AI front, and we're primarily at war with China. And if we look at the next generation of the kill chain, whether we're dealing with space, whether we're dealing with cyber, whether we're dealing with subsurface autonomous vehicles, hypersonic swarms, contested logistics, all of these technologies will be driven by AI. And so we have a kind of open and not kinetic warfare with China. And this will be kind of the ultimate test, I think, of the free enterprise system versus the totalitarian state.
As both nations vie to harness the transformative power of artificial intelligence, global attention is riveted on which will first master and then exploit its capabilities. What a far way we've come in such a relatively short period of history. It wasn't long ago, in the years after World War II, the U.S. and China found themselves on opposing sides of the emerging conflict on the Korean Peninsula, America defending the South and its Cold War adversaries supporting the Communist North. Approximately 37,000 Americans lost their lives during the Korean War. Add to that over 92,000 wounded and 8,000 missing. Nearly 5,000 military officers and soldiers were captured and held as POWs, among them CIA officer Jack Downey, who became our longest-held prisoner of war. This is a story I've known about in some sketchy detail from internal CIA histories for a couple of years. Given the vast library of narrative nonfiction chronicling the triumphs and pitfalls of our intelligence community over the decades, I've long wondered why the Downey affair escaped much notice. The drought is now over. Chronicling Jack Downey's life before, during, and after his imprisonment is today's guest, Barry Werth. An award-winning journalist and author, Barry is a master of the art of narrative nonfiction, with previous efforts detailing the final days of the Nixon administration, the mysterious world of Big Pharma, Charles Darwin's big ideas, and much more. In a minute, Barry joins us inside the Ice House to discuss his latest book, Prisoner of Lies, Jack Downey's Cold War, out now from Simon & Schuster. We're going to relive Jack's youth, his journey into the nascent CIA, span his two decades of imprisonment in China, his repatriation, and the life he lived after returning home. Our conversation with author Barry Werth is coming up right after this.
To prove that there is such a thing as free money, we gave people a little sample of Ibotta.
Hi, could I interest you in a sample from Ibotta?
What's going on?
It's just money.
Ibotta is an app that gives you cash back every time you shop.
What is it?
It's
money. So I can just take this.
This is real.
This is insane.
What's the catch?
There's no catch. It's just cash.
Get cash back every time you shop with Ibotta.
Welcome back. Remember, please, to subscribe wherever you listen and rate and review us on Apple Podcasts so other folks know where to find us. Our guest today, Barry Werth, is an award-winning journalist and author of 6 books, including his latest, Prisoner of Lies, Jack Downey's Cold War, out now from Simon & Schuster. Werth's articles have appeared in The New Yorker, The New York Times Magazine, and GQ, among others, and he's taught journalism and nonfiction writing at Smith, Mount Holyoke, and Boston University in my homeland, the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. Barry, thanks so much for joining us inside the Ice House.
Thanks for having me on.
What was your research process like using texts of the past and accessible information on Downey to provide a further glimpse of his life as both a free citizen and then a Chinese prisoner of war?
Back in 2002, Downey was still alive. He had been approached numerous times during his life to author his own book, to cooperate with others on books that they were writing, to do documentaries, and he always declined for reasons that we can talk about later. And I approached him, and he thanked me very much and said, no, thank you. I really don't want to go back there. I approached him again in 2010. I got the same response. And then he died in 2014. And I realized at that point that there was a possibility. I knew that the CIA had done some internal review of this and that it had looked at the situation itself. At that point, I approached Downey's family. I also approached the CIA, and I started gathering whatever string was available, knowing that ultimately the book was going to rise or fall on my ability to characterize his time in prison there.
So besides 31 Days, some of the books previously include The Antidote and The Billion Dollar Molecule that details Joshua Boger's founding of Vertex and the fight against Big Pharma. Also, Banquet at Delmonico's discussing Charles Darwin's ideas in post-Civil War America. What attracts you to this genre, and how did your writing process for Prisoner of Lies compare to some of the previous works?
Well, I started out in journalism, and I learned long-form journalism working for a magazine called New England Monthly back in the late 80s. And then started writing for national magazines. And then I did what a lot of nonfiction writers were doing at the time, which is I used some of my magazine pieces as both a template and a launching pad for a book-length project. I didn't really have that option here. I knew the bare bones of the Downey story. I knew I was interested. I thought maybe I could get it, which is always, of course, the final judgment. You know, you can become extremely fascinated. You can become obsessed by a story, but you have to believe that you're going to be able to fill in all the details. And I think rather naively, I thought that was going to be true in this case. I thought I would be able to get some cooperation from the CIA since they were starting to do their own look at this. I thought I would be able to get cooperation from Downey's family, but I didn't know any of that. I simply believed that the fact that it had been laying there for such a long time and nobody had written it meant, A, that it might be a game worth the candle. It might be pursuing because it was so interesting. And B, somehow I was going to be able to rise above the reporting challenges. But it was purely faith. To generalize, I get very excited about these stories when I first hear about them. I start to imagine what they might look like and what it might take to get them. But you don't really know until you get into it. And then it's a years long slog. It's leveraging one piece of information and one source to get to another. And this one took an extremely long time for a lot of reasons, which I'm happy to discuss. But essentially, it starts with a sense that the story must be told and that you somehow, the writer, are the one who can and should do it.
Well, as a guy who got his start at New England Monthly and lives sort of in central Massachusetts near the Connecticut border, and this also put you sort of in the right place geographically to get in the head and life of Downey and his family. Early in the book, you describe Jack as being from Wallingford, Connecticut, just down 84 or so from where you are. as a young man with the ability to lead, a combination of ease, grace, daring, grit, and kindness. I'm going to quote you there. Also qualities that stemmed both from his character and the influence of his uncle, Morton Downey, a celebrated singer and radio host of the time. While the Downey name resonated through the New Haven suburb from which he hailed, who was Jack Downey beyond this familial legacy?
It's important to see Downey as a member of his generation. Downey was born in 1930, so he grew up in the Depression, but he was too young to fight in World War II. Now, of course, we remember the particularly the men of that generation as the so-called greatest generation because of their bravery, because of their heroism, because of their sacrifice. Now, imagine you're a young adolescent and you're watching the war unfold, you know, riveted to it, and seeing how all of these great qualities and characteristics, particularly of manhood, but just in of humanity in general, are being paraded out every day. But you're a kid still. You're looking up at this. And so Downey graduated from Choate, which is a boarding school in central Connecticut, in 1947, right after the war. And he and his classmates all were champing at the bit to exceed themselves and distinguish themselves and show that they were, that, you know, that they could do what the generation just before them had done. He describes his generation as my little narrow post-war generation. The generation was also described in Time magazine as the silent generation, wary of ideologies, cautious, concerned. But I think it's really important to see him in that light. This was a generation that had something to prove. His father died when he was 8 years old. He was the oldest of three children, so he became the man in the family very quickly.
How did that death affect him, becoming the man of the family so quick?
In his memoir, he just says, I knew that I loved him and missed him, and I knew that everything had changed. His mother obviously relied on him more than parents ordinarily rely on their 8 year olds. He really had to step up. But I think, you know, I spent a lot of time thinking about this man and what were intrinsic characteristics and what was learned along the way. He had within him a balance of both compassion and strength, and also curiosity and affection for other people. So he had a lot of really good qualities from the get-go, which I think raised him up as much as the necessity of having to help out his mother. He went on to Choate, which among the elite boarding schools is the one that has always been most focused on creating future leaders. John Kennedy, of course, went to Choate. When John Kennedy famously said, "Ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country," he was cribbing directly from the headmaster at Choate, who routinely would say, "Ask not what Choate can do for you, ask what you can do for Choate." So he had a proper training. He was an extraordinary athlete, heavyweight wrestler, also played football, a favorite of his peers and masters, class president at Choate, only applied to one school, as many prep school students then did. He applied to Yale and got in. And so in the spring of 1947, just as Truman and Marshall were, in quotations, losing China to the communists, he went off to Yale. And that's really where the emergent Jack Downey, the Jack Downey who would go off to fight with the CIA against the Chinese government, really started to come together.
Yeah, so he ends up graduating with the Yale class of 51. And as you say, while he was at Yale, not only was he a great athlete, he's also a traveler, a member of St. Anthony Hall. How did he end up getting introduced to this nascent organization, the CIA, and how did he first learn about this OSS-like opportunity after college? You know, you and I, wherever we went to college, we think, what can we do that's super exciting? How did this fall into his lap?
You're right to bring up the OSS. Probably the most famous operatives in the OSS were the so-called Jedburgh teams. So these were young American and Belgian primarily paramilitary spies who airlifted ahead of the D-Day invasion. So they went into occupied France and they went into other portions of occupied Europe, and they were to lay the groundwork for the invasion, partly through intelligence gathering, partly through assassination. They had a motto that was something like arrive, kill, vanish, or something along those lines. But it was William Colby, the future director of the CIA, was a Jedburgh. But in any case, up and through World War II, we didn't have a permanent intelligence service. We only had these ad hoc services that were constructed when we needed them. But after World War II, it was determined that the United States really needed a permanent ongoing intelligence service. And the CIA was formed in 1946 or 47. I can't remember exactly. So the young CIA, which was confronted with how does the United States use its spy service in this new war, this Cold War, inherited what I consider to be an unearned swagger from the OSS. It didn't really have any experience of its own, but it had many former OSS operatives involved, and it took its cues primarily from the British spy service, MI6. And in the late 40s, began a program of running secret wars around the world. The first one was in Albania. It was a catastrophe. It was the same model as the one in China. That is, the idea was to recruit Albanian nationals who had been exiled from their country and were determined to go back, airlift them, airdrop them in, and arrange for them to somehow make common cause with people who were already there on the ground in order to build a movement against the government. In that case, the communist government of Enver Hoxha. And actually, the first operatives were brought in by boat, and they were quickly swept up and captured, and in most cases executed. When the airdrops started, almost every single one of them was scooped up almost as soon as they hit the ground, because the mission had been betrayed by Kim Philby, the British master spy of that period. He was in Washington during this period. He knew all about the plans, the locations, everything. They were passed on. And as I say, the Albanian government practically captured these guys as they were falling out of the sky. They were all executed. And what's more, up to 40 of their relatives were also executed as a lesson to others. But in any case, the CIA had this operational fantasy that it would somehow be able to foment revolutions against communist countries by using exiles under the training of the CIA.
As Downey joins the CIA as part of a class, I guess, of about 35 recruits, completes his training, awaits his assignment, the Korean War is underway. The domestic political climate is rife with communist acquisitions, largely driven by Senator Joe McCarthy. I just want to hear a brief clip.
One communist on the faculty of one university is one communist too many. One communist among the American advisors at Yalta was one communist too many. And even if there were only one communist in the State Department, even if there are only one communist in the State Department, that would still be one communist too many.
One communist too many, Barry. Amid all these widespread accusations by McCarthy and others within the federal government, how did young Jack react to that, and how did this political climate influence his eagerness to get his assignment and join the war effort?
I'm glad you asked that. We'll go back to Yale for a minute. So you've got this pent-up generation, this little narrow post-war generation, eager to prove itself. The CIA during Downey's, after we got involved in the Korean War in 1950, heavily recruited among all the Ivies, probably the most among Yale. And when the recruiters came, they'd have 20 or 25 young men sitting in a room. And what they said was, you're going to be able to do work that was exciting and meaningful as much as the Jedbergs did during World War II. And they asked them literally, how would you feel about being dropped behind enemy lines? Now, this is during Korea, when the war was already stalemated. The conditions on the ground were brutal. You know, people fought and died to advance a few yards. And here, this brand new spy organization is coming in and saying, you can do the most exciting, most meaningful, most glamorous work. We're coming to you because you're the best and the brightest. And up to 100 of Downey's classmates signed up for the CIA. It's a remarkable figure. In a class of 1,000, 10%, apparently took the bait and decided to, they would rather do this than be fighting in a trench somewhere in Korea. So, and they were all very gung-ho. They were deeply anti-communist. That wasn't, you know, that was a majority position then. And they were dying to get into action. So it wasn't really that hard to recruit them and or for that matter, indoctrinate them. They knew who the enemy was and they wanted to get out and fight. The fighting was on now and they wanted to be in it.
So here we are then in 1951, right out of school, Jack Downey arrived at Atsugi Naval Air Station in Japan, where he gets assigned to a desk job rather than, as you say, you know, jumping behind enemy lines in South Korea. His mission was to train Third Force elements in China to lead an anti-communist uprising on the mainland. After 4 months, I guess, he confided in his friend Rufus Phillips, saying, and I'm going to quote him here, "I'm feeling qualms of conscience about the service since the job hasn't turned out quite like I expected, although it may be in the foreseeable future, and that's the damned rub. I'd hate to quit and then see the roof cave in the next day." How did Jack address his desire to leave that desk job at Atsugi and have what he perceived as a greater impact in the war?
So they all these young guys get to Japan and most of them are sent off right away into action. But they held Jack back primarily because he had tested higher on leadership than the others. And they were hoping that they would be able to use him to train these Chinese nationals and incorporate them into this Third Force. But it was a desk job and all his friends were off at war. They'd come back, they'd have R&R and there was no question about it. They would say, boy, it must be awfully comfy here. He really was starting to feel very frustrated and misused and disappointed in himself that he wasn't in the action. He was extremely pent up, frustrated and desperate to get into action. And there was finally an opportunity for him to go and train a group of these Third Force fighters who were supposed to be dropped into China, and he jumped at it. So he was probably no more relieved in his life than to put Japan behind him and to be going to Korea where the action was.
So here's where the story gets really crazy, because you imagine this as being put on film in a movie scene, and you can't imagine that it actually was something the CIA would attempt to do. It's November 1952, and Jack, alongside another CIA operative, Dick Fecto, was designated by Joe Kiyonaga to substitute for a couple of recruits moving what was known as a snatch pickup over China. Their objective was to extract one of the Third Force couriers from the ground and lift him onto a slow-moving C-47 just flying above the rooftops. And I've seen diagrams of this and the contraption that was used, and it just seems crazy. And of course, the mission ends in failure. The plane gets shot down. There's anti-aircraft fire coming from the trees, and both pilots get killed, and Jack and Dick get captured. Was this mission doomed from its inception, Barry?
Well, I think it was. So the plan was to drop two groups of agents into China, into the Forever White Mountains, which is about 60 miles north of the Korean border. They dropped the first group in. This is not Jack and Dick, but the CIA dropped in one group just to see whether they could survive. And they never heard from them again. But then in late summer 1952, they dropped in a second group. And when they did hear back from them, and this was all conducted by Morse code, mind you. It seemed that they had accomplished what they set out to do, which was to sneak into China and begin to set up operations on the ground. At one point, they got a message back saying, we've made contact with a former Kuomintang general. He's interested in working with us. This is starting to take off. We need to send in a courier so that we have a go-between. They dropped in a courier, and then they got a message back saying, we're facing winter. We need more supplies, and you need to try to get the courier out because he's got loads of information, and we're moving on this. So as you say, they arranged this so-called snatch pickup, which had never been used in the field before. It had been practiced, on various airstrips, and they borrowed it basically from rural mail collection. There was a winch in the back of the plane with a hook attached to it, and they would drop the hook out and try to hook a bag of mail or a marlin on a fishing line, hook the courier from the ground, and reel them up into the plane. Downey and Fecteau were not supposed to be flying over enemy territory, but at the last minute, the winch and hook operators dropped out for whatever reason, and Downey and Fecteau were ordered to do this, and they knew how to do it. And as I said, they were champing to get into the action. So as Downey said, he would not have objected. He was eager to do it. He was ordered to do it, he wasn't under duress. And the plan was this: to fly from Korea, get to the place where they were, the meetup point, by midnight, and on the first pass, drop a bundle down with some poles and some rope and a harness that they could assemble into a kind of a goalpost, with the courier laying on the ground facing in the direction of the plane, connected to an elastic band up above, and then in the hour that it took Downey's plane to circulate and come back, they got all this set up, and they were coming in now low and slow, practically at stall speed, at treetop level. There were fires set to mark the target. And as they got close enough, the communist soldiers peeled back tarpaulins. They had American machine guns. They fired into the plane. They knew they were coming. It was essentially an ambush, as Depp said, just like in the movies. So they fired into the cockpit. They killed the pilots. And amazingly, the plane didn't cartwheel when it hit the ground. It hit flat. And though it burst into flames, Downey and Fecteau ripped off their parachutes and stumbled out of the plane and were immediately surrounded by Chinese troops. And they started yelling at him, "You are Jack. You are Jack. You were in China. You are Jack." And he had not really been prepared. He was told, if you get captured, tell them you're on a leafleting mission that went off course. Tell them anything, but don't tell them you're CIA. But in any case, they were marched off and led to a farmhouse first, and then a local cell, and then the interrogations began.
At what point did Jack realize kind of what was going on? And in the old adage of knowing your value, like he's a captive, he has information, he has an ability to preserve himself if he can do the right thing under captivity. How did he strategically leverage his value to ensure that maybe he never was going to reach a point where he was deemed expendable and they'd hang him or shoot him?
Well, A, he was 22. B, we were not at war with China. So he knew going in that he didn't have any of the protections of the Geneva Conventions. He was not going to be a prisoner of war. As the Chinese said, we can do anything we want with you. He was terrified. Both of them were. But they didn't want to confess immediately. And he and Fecteau each withstood about 2 weeks of intense interrogation. 4 hours on, 4 hours off. As he said, I lied, and then I embellished that lie with another lie, and then I embellished that lie with another lie. I tried to conceal and hide and obfuscate in every way that I could until I was dizzy, spinning, trying to keep track of my own lies. But he didn't know if they were going to kill him. He didn't, he thought, you know, maybe if I tell them what I know, maybe they'll kill me. If I don't tell them what I know, maybe they'll kill me. He didn't know whether the United States knew that he had been captured, and he wasn't able to have any contact with FECTO. So he was entirely alone in addressing this. And after a couple of weeks, as I said, he finally confessed to being a CIA agent.
I guess maybe going back to his training at Choate and Yale, where they give you some decent literature and writing courses, he knows perhaps that he could improve his conditions if he creates a written narrative or as part of this confession. And I think it was 3,000 pages worth, most of it filled with drivel. How did he spawn the inspiration to craft that literary opus? And do you have any information about where these papers might be, assuming they could possibly still exist?
I compare him to Scheherazade. He felt like as long as he had a story to tell, they would keep him alive. And after the initial, he was in shackles for the first 11 months that he was in Chinese prison and in solitary. Didn't know really where he was or whether Fecto was nearby. And they, after a while, they kind of left him alone, I think, probably just to think about his situation. They said to him again and again, tell the truth and your future will be bright. Lie and your future will be dark. Don't tell the truth and your future will be dark. So he had a lot of time to think about this. And as you say, he was actually quite a wonderful writer. He had taken writing classes at Yale and had, I think, a journalist's passion to put things down on paper. And it suddenly dawned on him after about 9 months when they started to ratchet up the pressure, said, listen, sooner or later, I'm going to have to tell them everything. But if I tell them in writing, I'll control the ball game. And so he said, I'll do this, but I'd like to have a written confession rather than an oral confession. And they agreed. So they gave him a pen and some paper, and he sat on a stool next to his bed. And for another 9 months, he read everything that he could think of. I mean, he did confess everything that he knew, but it was packed inside, as you say, mounds and mounds and mounds of drivel and irrelevant sees, and a kind of a postmodern writing style, so that he would say, well, I met with so-and-so on a Wednesday. No, maybe it was Tuesday. I can't remember. Perhaps it was, he just stretched it out and stretched it out and stretched it out. And in the end, it was 3,000 pages. Now, as to where they are, whether they exist, I thought going into this that I might need to go to China and try to track some of this down. But I never got there. And I'm not sure that I would have found anything. I mean, I don't speak Chinese. I wouldn't know how to navigate that system. And fortunately I was able finally to get his prison memoir, which explained enough of it so that I didn't really have to try to, do that really, really hard digging of locating some of these materials.
So about a year after his capture, July 27th, 1953, the Korean armistice gets signed, marking the end of hostilities between the North and the South. I want to listen to just a bit of a Pathé newsreel as President Dwight Eisenhower announces the end of the war to the American public.
My fellow citizens, tonight we greet with prayers of thanksgiving the official news that an armistice was signed almost an hour ago in Korea. It will quickly bring to an end the fighting between the United Nations forces and the communist armies. For this nation, the cost of repelling aggression has been high. In thousands of homes, it has been incalculable. It has been paid in terms of tragedy. With special feelings of sorrow and of solemn gratitude, we think of those who were called upon to lay down their lives in that far-off land to prove once again that only courage and sacrifice can keep freedom alive upon the earth.
So while their fellow prisoners of war, like General Frank Schwabel, were repatriated to the U.S. after Eisenhower's remarks, Downey and Fecto, they have to remain in captivity. What distinguished their treatment from that of the other prisoners of war?
We hadn't declared war on China. We had declared war on North Korea. And as the Chinese pointed out, they were not prisoners of the battle. They were involved in secret agent activity against the Communist Chinese government, the PRC. And they, as I said earlier, they had no protections from the Geneva Conventions. So their situation was completely different. And because our country didn't acknowledge what they were doing there, and in fact, it disavowed it, said that they were civilian employees of the army whose plane had disappeared over the Sea of Japan, they had no leg to stand on. They didn't know that the war ended. They didn't find out until a year afterwards. But they weren't treated as other POWs were because of this unique situation where they were actually spies.
Because of this unique situation, it was then, I guess, November 1954, 2 years after their plane had got shot down, that the Chinese government, its news agency, broadcast to the world that both Downey and Fecteau were, in fact, alive. How did both families of Downey and Fecteau and the federal government initially react, having presumed that both had been killed in that plane crash in 52?
So I'll try to set this up. So now we're in the fall of 1954, and the first Kimoi and Matsu conflict, the Formosa Strait conflict, was heating up. And now they'd been captured for 2 years. The American government always assumed that if they had been captured, at some point the Chinese would tell the world. Well, that point didn't come until 2 years later. 2 years after Mary Downey, Jack's mother accepted that he was missing and most likely dead. And then suddenly there's this announcement. So I'll get to Mary first. She was a school teacher, and she gets a call down to the principal's office that there's a reporter on the phone. And the reporter says, the Chinese have just announced that they have somebody. Sounds like his name is Jack Downey. Do you have a son, Jack Downey? She believes he's dead. She's taken things off the wall. She's given all of his clothes and his possessions to his younger brother. She's never quite entirely gave up hope, but she believed he was dead. So this came as a severe shock to her that he might even be alive. I did get the chance to speak with Jack's younger brother, Bill. Their father being dead, their coaches, their athletic coaches, were always the sort of older senior figures in their lives. And Mary contacted the Yale wrestling coach to drive to Cambridge, where Bill was in graduate school, to tell him about it. And he said it was such a shock that he got on his bed and he slept for 17 hours. But as for the government, now they were really in a quandary, because there had been this cover story. And if they were to say, so our spies were captured and they received a trial, a fair trial with evidence and under the Chinese legal system, that would have been an acknowledgement that, in fact, we did have this secret war against China. But obviously they weren't going to do that. The point person was John Foster Dulles, the Secretary of State, and in his indignation, he said, the Chinese have never mentioned Downey and Fecteau before. It's just like them. They don't abide by any of the rules. This is an outrage. We don't understand how the Chinese came into possession of these men. He tried to put all of the blame back on China. And Eisenhower was subsequently asked at a press conference to comment on this. And he said, well, the situation is cloudy and I can't really comment on that. So, because the government was determined to stick with the cover story and deny what had actually happened, that really put Downey and Fecteau in a special kind of limbo.
The situation was cloudy and Downey and Fecteau in a serious case of limbo. After the break, we're going to continue our discussion of Jack Downey's imprisonment, as well as the over 20 years he spent as a prisoner of war. All that and more with Barry Werth is coming up right after this.
Sail through the heart of historic cities and unforgettable scenery with Viking. Unpack once and get closer to iconic landmarks, local life, and cultural treasures. Because when you experience Europe on a Viking longship, you'll spend less time getting there and more time being there. Viking, exploring the world in comfort.
Welcome back. If you are enjoying this conversation, want to hear more from guests like Barry Werth, author of Prisoner of Lies, and Jack Downey's Cold War, remember, please, to subscribe to the Inside the Ice House podcast wherever you listen and give us a 5-star rating, if you would, and a review on Apple Podcasts so other folks know where to find us. Before the break, we were discussing Jack Downey's life from humble origins in Wallingford, Connecticut, to joining the CIA right out of Yale, and the events that led to his capture by the Chinese in 1952. Despite the uncertainty of whether and when he might ever return home, Jack maintained a kind of resilience and optimistic spirit. How did he manage to persevere and maintain hope for his eventual release, even as the months and years were ticking by?
He didn't have that at first. He was panicked at first and desperately gamed out diplomatic scenarios whereby he might be released or included in a swap for a Chinese prisoner in the United States. The first probably three and a half years were very tough. He assumed that the United States government would be doing whatever it could to get him out. He knew he was a high value prisoner. He discovered during that time, as he said, that that brainwashing was really a myth. Now, if you remember, Americans were led to believe that the Chinese were soulless, that they had no regard for human life, and that they had developed brainwashing techniques where they could literally kind of scrub your soul and then rebuild your interior mind back into what they wanted it to be. And he, of course, had been fed some of this before he left, but he learned that that wasn't going to happen. He said they can't reach the inner recesses of your soul. So slowly he started to begin to think, this is my lot. I can survive this. And about 3.5 years in, he said, I just said to myself, enough of this crap. He stopped feeling sorry for himself, and he started to transform himself into what he described as the busiest man in Beijing. Now he's in solitary. He's got no resources, hardly anything to read. But over time, he started to live his life in a very monkish way. He scheduled his days down to the minute. He ran 10 miles either in place in his cell, or if he could get out into a courtyard, into very tight circles. He had been a great athlete, and he did calisthenics as much as he possibly could. He started to get a lot of reading material, mostly novels, which he devoured, and then histories, which he devoured. He read War and Peace 7 times over. The last time, he actually taught himself Russian so that he could read it in the original. Meticulous cell cleaning. As he said, he shrank his life down to simply surviving each minute, each day, with such focus that when he looked up, days and months and years had gone by. So it was this intense narrowing of his focus that he said enabled him to continue on.
As the years went by, Barry, 1958, for the first time since 1951, Jack Downey is reunited with his mother, Mary, his brother, Bill. Authorized by the State Department to visit China, Mary and Bill traveled to Beijing, then called Peking, where Jack was imprisoned. What were the emotions like during that reunion, and how much, if anything, did Jack reveal to his family about his experiences as a spy and his time in prison?
So let me try to set that up. So after the Kimoi and Matsu crisis, the U.S. government decided to turn to U.N. General Secretary Dag Hammarskjöld to try to negotiate their release. And Hammarskjöld went to China, crashed the gate, as he said. No UN General Secretary had ever been to a foreign capital in precisely in that sort of role, and was able to get many prisoners released. But because there had been no acknowledgement about what Downey and Fechter were doing, the Chinese refused to even discuss it. There were negotiations afterwards. At that time, no Americans, not even journalists, could travel to China, to the PRC. There was a complete ban under the State Department. And the Chinese were eager for some kind of recognition and normalization. So they invited Downey's family and Fechter's family and the families of other POWs to come. And John Foster Dulles said, no, that would be recognizing them. We're not going to barter for the souls of innocent civilians who've been wrongfully detained. So for years, even though the invitation was on the table, the Chinese, that Mary Downey and Bill Downey couldn't go and visit. And finally, Downey was able to see them after he had been in prison for almost 6 years. He was obviously by that time desperate to see them, but at the same time he really worried about what seeing them would do to him, because he realized how constrained and diminished his life had become. He also worried, and this was borne out by the fact that when his mother and brother were finally brought in, there was a photographer and a stenographer there, that the Chinese were hoping that he would confess to his mother and brother, and then they were going to broadcast that confession to the world. So he was very anxious about seeing them. He was about to start talking I think he said something like, "Mother, the Chinese have told me I can talk to you about my crimes." And his brother, Bill's younger brother, cast him a harsh glance and said, which in effect said, "Don't do it." And when he took the cue, he didn't start telling them anything about what he had been doing there. And the photographer and the stenographer finally left. But the meeting with the families was so traumatic for Fechter that he told his mother, don't come back. Fechter had a 20-year sentence, by the way. Downey was sentenced to life. But he said, this is just too painful for both of us. Don't come back. But Downey's brother and mother went back several times before he was ultimately released.
So you mentioned that Fechter had a 20-year sentence. From that point that Mary and Bill were visiting, I guess it's another 13 years from 58 until Fechter gets released in 71. I want to listen just to a little bit of a Pathé newsreel as Fechter reflects on the conditions and his own unwavering sense of hope.
What was a day like there? How do you spend a day, day after day, for 19 years?
Reading, walking in the cell, 1 hour outside, walking. The same thing day after day.
Did you say writing in the cell, reading?
Walking.
Walking.
You mean it's like, you would think of like an American prison?
No, because there are no bars.
No bars?
No bars.
No bars.
No bars.
It's four walls, a door with a peak hole in it, looking through. That's covered. And the window is covered halfway up, so you cannot look out the window.
Was there any point at which you sort of gave up hope of getting out of prison?
I never gave up hope, no.
How did Jack cope with the emotional weight of seeing Dick return home while he remained in captivity?
Jack knew a lot more. I mean, he had been a trainer for the agents who were dropped in. He knew much, much more about the mission. He had been much more central to it than Fechter. Fechter, though he was a CIA officer, had only been brought in at the last moment. So he understood that they were going to receive different sentences. In fact, at their trial, a number of the Chinese agents were sentenced to death. There's a very dramatic scene where Downey is standing waiting to be sentenced, and the judge is pronouncing the sentences down the line, says 10 years, 10 years, 20 years, life, death. And then Fechter was sentenced to 20 years and Downey was sentenced to life. And he said it was like having a granite slab laid on his chest. He knew Fechter was going to go home before him. At this point, I don't know what he thought about what the United States was doing to try to negotiate his release. But as I said, he thought something eventually would change, an administration would change, the Chinese government would change, something would change that would free him. But when Fechter left after almost 20 years there, Downey, I believe, had his sentence reduced by 5 years. primarily for his good behavior. But and at that point, he thought, you know, I'm not going to die here an old man. I am going to get out. So he it wasn't as if he were crushed that his friend and compatriot was free and he was having to stay on alone. I think he just thought, I'll get out eventually, and this is what it's going to look like.
So Barry, talking about administrations eventually changing, the Johnson administration gives way to the Nixon administration. 2 years after Fecteau returned home, Jack Downey's release finally comes about after President Nixon personally appeals to Chinese Premier Zhou Enlai, prompted by Jack's mother, Mary, suffering a severe stroke back home. Do you think Jack would have remained in prison longer if not for Mary's illness?
No, I don't. A very important person in all of this is Jerry Cohen, who was a classmate of Jack's and was went to Yale Law School and became a Harvard law professor and B, probably the premier expert in the Chinese legal system. Jerry taught himself Mandarin, really very distinguished person. And in 1966, at Jack's 15th college reunion, his classmates recruited him to try to do what could be done to get Jack out. Now, that was the middle of the Cultural Revolution. We had no way of communicating with the Chinese. They were completely absorbed in their own internal struggles. Johnson was still president. We were still in the midst of escalating during the Vietnam War. And as Cohen said, what I realized is that we had to somehow get closer, figure out a way to approach the Chinese. When Nixon was elected and chose Henry Kissinger, another Harvard professor, as his national security advisor, Cohen wrote to Kissinger and said, he apprised him of the situation. He said, this is one of the longest standing disputes we've had with the Chinese. I think the formula for getting him out would be to reassess the situation, acknowledge that Downey was a spy, and apologize. So literally from the first weeks of the Nixon administration, Kissinger was saying to Nixon, if you know, whatever we do with China, Downey's got to be part of the package. And this is what we're going to have to try to do. And it took now from 68 to 70. When did Nixon go to China? 71?
72, February of 72.
Took 4 years. But in some sense, the Downey negotiations were the linchpin of the larger normalization discussion, because the Chinese were not going to release him until the United States acknowledged that we indeed had a secret war against China and that Downey was a captive of that war.
And that's why I find the thinking and planning of Nixon's trip and all the related factors so fascinating, because even this was wound into it in one way or another. I mean, it's easy, Barry, from where we sit in the vantage point of history, looking back at Nixon especially, and also Kissinger, the caricature that we have of Nixon during Watergate and in his final days, and what we think of him generally as a president based on the final tumultuous year of his presidency. But how does the Downey affair cast a new light, if any, on the image that we have of the president and the secretary of state waging an empathetic diplomatic marathon on behalf of one of their citizens?
You know, Nixon, obviously a very complex historical figure. The China normalization, really, you know, his crowning achievement. Nixon was a brilliant, brilliant political player. You're right to bring up the visit to China. Right out literally before Nixon went out and had that first famous toast where he said, this is the week that changed the world. He was in a back room saying to Chou En-lai, what can we do to get Downey out? It was almost the last thing they discussed before that historic statement. So he was on it, and he realized how important it was to the Chinese. To the Chinese, this was the fact that we had flipped everything on them, that that Foster Dulles and subsequent U.S. officials were chastising the Chinese for wrongfully detaining him. The United States made it appear for a generation that we were right and they were wrong, that we were moral and they were immoral, that we were just and they were unjust, when in fact we had tried to invade their country with this small force and denied it and denied it and denied it. It really stuck in their craws, and it's understandable. They were trying very hard, in some sense, to show that they could at least live by some of the rules of international law, but everything had been inverted, right and wrong, truth and lies. And finally, for Nixon to concede, and the way that he did it was so brilliant, concede that, yes, in fact, Downey was a spy. That was the thing that brought the resolution of the Downey saga finally to a close.
Brought it to a close. Part 3 of Prisoner of Lies. You mentioned this a little bit earlier in our conversation, but you remind us of one of the great American espionage novels that it was eventually made into a spy thriller, Lawrence Harvey and Frank Sinatra in John Frankenheimer's The Manchurian Candidate, and the perception of what it would be like for imprisoned Americans in a mysterious country, in the same way that we don't understand the inversion of perceptions between of what China was all about. Downey and Fecto are now home. Tell us about the winding history of that film, how United Artists and Sinatra worked to keep it out of circulation, and what it tells us about Downey and Fecto's return to freedom.
Okay, so the novel, Manchurian Candidate, I can't remember the author's name at the moment, but he was a publicist for Walt Disney.
Condon, right? Richard Condon.
Richard Condon. It was a satirical novel, and it was the basic premise was that a group of American flyers were shot down and taken from North Korea into China to be brainwashed, and then one of them, the one played by Lawrence Harvey, was going to be turned into effectively a zombie killer who could be triggered at any moment. His mother, who in the film was played by Angela Lansbury, was married to a McCarthy-like figure who was the vice president. And the plot was to get the Lawrence Harvey character to assassinate the president so that her husband could become the president. So it was an assassination movie with these undertones of brainwashing. Now the American flyers had been in Chinese in a Chinese camp for 3 days, and during that time, if you've seen the film or you've read the book, they had their minds wiped clean and they were brainwashed. And this is, of course, what everybody expected when Downey came home, that he was going to be somehow altered in the deepest possible way. So Nixon got Downey out by finally confessing at the press conference after the Vietnam War ended. This was January now, 1973. We had an armistice with the North Vietnamese. All of the questions at this press conference, even though Watergate was in the air, questions weren't about Watergate. They were all about the prisoners. When are the prisoners coming home? Are you going to meet the prisoners when they get off the plane in California? Nixon said, no, we're not going to grandstand. This is a time when they need to be able to get together with their families and have some privacy. And the very last question, which was a plant, was, well, what about Downey? Downey's been in Chinese prison for 21 years. And Nixon's exact quote is, Downey, as you know, is a different case. Downey involves a CIA agent. Now, he was wrong about him being an agent. He wasn't an agent. He was an officer. But that was the acknowledgement. That was finally the acknowledgement that the U.S. government was no longer going to pretend that Downey was an innocent civilian wrongfully detained. And that's what set in motion the release. As you said, Downey's mother had a stroke. At that point, there was communication directly between the White House and Zhou Enlai, and they got him back as fast as they could because they thought he'd been a model prisoner, and they thought he should be able to see his mother while she was still alive. So he gets back in March of 73, and he gets to the hospital in Connecticut, where his mother is You know, she's tangled up in tubes from various kinds of bottles. She's been slipping in and out of consciousness, but she's awake and she's aware of the situation. She says to the doctor, you know, sit me up straight. I don't want to be on my back like this. And she sees Jack and she says to him, you're going to be a celebrity now. Don't let it go to your head. And then within 15 minutes after that, he's rushed downstairs to a press conference. There are 100 reporters in a makeshift press room in the hospital, and they're starting to fire away questions. Now, the reporters are all wondering, this guy, he's Rip Van Winkle. He has stepped out of time. You know, he's been in prison since the Korean War. This is the end of the Vietnamese War. We have these presumptions about the way Chinese treat their prisoners. The brainwashing theme was always underlying, and they start to ask him questions, and he's forthright. He's relaxed. He's not bitter in any way. He does say, you know, no, I wouldn't do it again. I don't think anybody gained anything by it, but he was himself again, you know, getting back to these qualities, these intrinsic qualities of empathy and self-awareness and a kind of a sense of humor about himself. You know, Downey was a kind of a fatalist. At some point he realized this is out of my hands. You know, I am as his son Jackie says, you know, God's unwitting stooge in all of this. And he saw the irony. He didn't blame the Chinese. He thought they treated him reasonably well. He didn't even blame the United States government until he found out some years later about the fact that the Chou En Lai had offered to return him in facto in order to allow American journalists into China. He was bitter for about a day or so, it seemed, about John Foster Dulles, realizing, you know, if Dulles had conceded who he was and what he was doing there, he probably would have been released 15 years earlier. But he was a really kind of an exceptional person. He uses the word unbitter, and I like that word. And the other thing was he wasn't affected by all the tumult and noise of the 60s and 70s. So he was kind of, all those years in prison, he just became more and more who he was. And he wasn't, you know, those were very disillusioning years. We all had, you know, those of us who grew up after World War II, we had hopes and expectations about what America was, what life meant, and a lot of the events of that period, the assassinations, the war, crushed all that. But he didn't go through that. He was not only unbitter, he was undisillusioned, and so he came out whole, in phenomenal shape physically, and ready to go. You know, he was just glad that he'd finally been released. Now you think about it, you know, I'm not sure I could spend a night in a Chinese prison cell. And he spent 20 years. The characters in Manchurian Candidate had spent all of 3 days.
So about a decade after his release, 1982, repatriated, reintroduced Jack Downey, chose to challenge Lowell Weicker in Connecticut's Senate election. Despite benefiting from the strong name recognition that he had, also enthusiastic backing from some influential figures in New Haven politics, Downey's campaign faltered, and it led to his decision to withdraw from the race in May of 1983. What factors led to the lack of success of Downey the politician, Downey the public figure, after this person that you paint who sort of got to skip the tumult of the 60s and 70s and emerge as the same character that emerged from Yale in 1951?
Well, I think the main problem, there were lots of problems there. I mean, he was running against Toby Moffat, who was very popular, who eventually did get the nomination. Weicker was a kind of middle of the roader. He was the first Republican to call for Nixon's resignation. And Downey, though a lifelong Democrat, was also a middle of the roader. But the main thing was he had this giant blank in his history that he couldn't account for, you know, and in fact, his handler said, you should write a prison memoir, which we can turn into a campaign autobiography if you get past the primary. And at that point, he actually did write about his experience in China, but and his training, his mission, his capture, his interrogations, the works. He wrote about it all. But at that point, he wasn't talking about it. So here's this guy who people admire because he spent 20 years in Chinese prison and came out whole, but they don't know anything about him, and he can't really tell them anything about him. He was, you know, I don't know how much of this was him being faithful to the CIA, not talking about the situation that had gotten him there, and how much of it was his own reticence and simply not wanting to go back there. But the people he could have won a House seat. There was an open House seat, and he could have won it, but he had his heart set on going to the Senate. It's interesting because he was released at exactly the time that John McCain was released, and McCain did enter politics by winning a House seat and was obviously a very effective politician from that point on. Downey had higher aspirations. I wouldn't want to serve in the House of Representatives. I don't think he wanted to serve in the House of Representatives. He wanted to be a senator. But he was totally outflanked. I mean, there was already a popular front runner in Toby Moffat. George Bush's brother was running on the Republican side. There were a lot of heavily funded, much better known candidates. But then when the campaign was over, he took the prison memoir and put it in his drawer and didn't take it out again until his wife found it after he died.
Well, I mean, he didn't get to the Senate. Neither did Toby Moffat, by the way. But instead, he gets to the Connecticut State Superior Court, appointed in 1987 by Connecticut's Governor William O'Neill. And he presided over a lot of cases involving delinquency, child welfare. And then his tenure became a little controversial when he ruled in favor of an 18-year-old girl who had initially relinquished her baby for adoption, but then later sought to regain custody, overriding the prospective adoptive parents. That decision garnered a lot of national attention and subjected Downey to some criticism. In your opinion, did the ruling tarnish or maybe undermine the legacy that he'd built from his CIA service in his two decades of imprisonment?
I'm not sure. So briefly, an 18-year-old girl in Connecticut has a baby. Nobody knows she's pregnant. We've seen these kinds of stories before. She just claims that she didn't know she was pregnant. She gets picked up on the street, taken to a hospital in North Haven, and flees that night, and then decides sometimes later that she wants the baby back, by which time the state had found, let's call them pre-adoptive parents. The adoption hadn't gone through, but they agreed to take the baby under the assumption that that they would be able to keep her eventually. And Downey initially, in order to accelerate that process before the birth mother showed up, approved that. And then the birth mother did show up, and he looked into how hard the state had looked into trying to locate her, and realized that they had done very little to find out who the birth mother was. And he overruled himself. He changed his decision, decided that the birth mother still had rights. And that's what the case hinged on. The pre-adoptive parents were a couple that had tried very hard for many years to have a child of their own and couldn't. They were hardworking suburban people. The birth mother was having difficulty with her family. She moved out of the house. She was actually living in a homeless shelter when the court decided that she should be able to get her baby back. So this made Downey extremely unpopular in Connecticut, especially. But this was the period of court TV, and court watchers around the country were just alarmed that he would take this child from a safe situation and put it in a potentially dangerous situation. As it turned out, the whole thing was appealed. The appeal was led by Richard Blumenthal, now senator, then attorney general of the state, up to the state Supreme Court. And the state Supreme Court ruled in Downey's favor, that he did have jurisdiction. He was in his rights to reverse the original decision. He never expressed any doubts or hesitations or regrets about it, as far as I know. I've talked to a lot of his colleagues and people who worked in the courthouse. He felt that there were many other issues about what's best for the child. Is being with the biological mother best for the child, or other kinds of security? Are they more important? And so it became a famous case. I don't think it really detracted from his legacy. I think he felt like he did what needed doing, and that he approached it, with honesty and integrity and followed the law.
As we wrap up, Barry, you mentioned the acknowledgments that Jack had declined, and we talked about this earlier, declined your interest in telling his story twice during his lifetime. When he had passed, it was his wife, Audrey, and their son, Jack, who granted you permission to go forward with writing the book. Given his reluctance to discuss himself, how do you imagine he'd perceive this book today as he looks at your galleys with its detailed chronicling of the significant moments and experiences of his life?
I think he'd appreciate it. You know, of course, as his son Jackie said, I just think he didn't want to go back there during his lifetime. You know, he didn't want to have to relive it. But, you know, looking at it from his vantage point now, he's not having to relive it. He would only see that the whole story finally come out. I'll go out on a limb and say I think he'd be pleased to see how his story dovetailed with the larger political story of his times. One of the things that Jerry Cohen said is all those years in prison, Downey had no idea really what his experience meant. He didn't understand, for instance, during the Cultural Revolution that when there's a massive movement like that within a communist country, that every institution is affected and every individual is affected. I don't think he really quite knew how he fit in, if I can say, fit into the history of his times. And I think that's the thing that I've been able to show, is how this one man's story is illustrative of a much, much larger picture of the world during those decades.
A much larger picture of the world during those decades. Fascinating read. Really hit home for me because of my interest in this case in particular. Grateful for you writing it and also for spending time with us, Barry Werth, Inside the Ice House.
Terrific. Thanks so much. I really appreciated it.
That's our conversation for this week. Our guest was Barry Werth, author of Prisoner of Lies, Jack Downey's Cold War, out now from Simon & Schuster. If you like what you heard, please rate us on Apple Podcasts so other folks know where to find us. And if you've got a comment or a question you'd like one of our guests to tackle on a future show, make sure to leave a review, email us at icehouse@ice.com or tweet at us at icehousepodcast. Our show is produced by Lance Glynn with production assistance, editing and engineering from Ken Abel. Pete Ash is the director of programming and production at ICE, and I'm Josh King, your host, signing off from the library of the New York Stock Exchange. Thanks for listening. We'll talk to you next week.
Information contained in this podcast was obtained in part from publicly available sources and not independently verified. Neither ICE nor its affiliates make any representations or warranties, express or implied, as to the accuracy or completeness of the information, and do not sponsor, approve, or endorse any of the content herein, all of which is presented solely for informational and educational purposes. Nothing herein constitutes an offer to sell, a solicitation of an offer to buy any security, or a recommendation of any security or trading practice. Some portions of the preceding conversation may have been edited for the purpose of length or clarity.